It's episode 49 of the 2-Minute Terminator. I'm Ethan McKinley, your host, and on the other line is Ellie Fitzgerald.
Hi.
We're going to talk about the Terminator films as we watch 2 minutes of them and discuss them. Yes, 2 minutes at a time. Playing in the background is the bumper music for this episode, which is the main title from Battle Beyond the Stars by James Horner, who obviously went on to do Star Trek, Aliens, The Rocketeer, Avatar. And, yeah. Anything to say, Eleanor?
I'm loving the music. Got a love a bit of Horner.
And with that, we say hello, welcome, and hit the music. Yeah, no one heard that. Hit the music.
Oh, you dickhead.
Howdy, stranger.
Don't say howdy, stranger to me.
Hi. I'm Chief Master Sergeant William Candy.
Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
And we're back. As Ellie was saying, she is the co-host of the 2-Minute Terminator that I'd like to talk over. I have even more power when she calls in, so it's all good.
You have AIDS.
Not HIV, but full-blown AIDS.
She's got the
AIDS. In this episode, it's basically...
Question.
Before we start, it starts with John and Kate running to the nuclear fallout shelter. And when they actually get to the control room, John discovers that it's not actually the place where Skynet originates from. It's, in fact, a VIP nuclear fallout shelter. As lovingly pointed out, by the way, by listener James Spaulner, he is, in fact, right. This isn't a nuclear base. This is the place where you come to hide. And that's where they find themselves. Episode 49. Take it away, Ellie. We are going for the 1 minute. 1 hour 36 mark to the 1 hour.
Oh my god!
38 mark.
The devil's trying to leave Ethan's mouth.
What are these black spores of smoke shooting out of me?
What happens? Oh no, your mum isn't still smoking, is she?
I said, what are all these black spores and smoke shooting out of me? Doesn't matter, Ellie. I was trying to be funny and glib.
Oh, sorry, I didn't hear you. Because all I could hear was blah 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 blah. No, I'm joking. I had a question for you, but it has nothing to do with Terminator. Can I ask it yes or no?
I'll allow it.
Oh, thank you. Weird Science, Kelly LeBrock. So I'm talking about...
I'm listening.
She comes up to you and she goes, Ethan, I've just been dying for you to fuck me. Like, for so long. But I do have AIDS. So if you fuck me, you will have AIDS for the rest of your life. You can live with it. It won't kill you. But that's the only way it's going to happen. Would you fuck Kelly LeBrock?
No.
Really?
Yeah.
But then if you both had AIDS, you could be like, well, you're going to have to fuck me forever now. Because
she just find
we've got AIDS.
She'd find other people to give AIDS to. She was that irresistible. She wouldn't need me.
She's simply irresistible.
Who's anyway, dragging Ellie off the common again, where she likes to shit like all the other dogs, and getting her back on her lead, we are talking about the Terminator. What's that, Bonzo? The Terminator. Exactly. Go on, beg.
Did
right,
you,
now
did
talk
you
about
tell
Terminator.
Us what the bookends of this episode were?
I did. They get into the nuclear shelter and then discover at the end that it's actually a shelter for VIPs. As I said, lovingly pointed out by listener James Spaulner a few episodes back.
Awesome. So, my first
question...
Can
you sense the tension? Can you sense the tension in the air?
It's all sexual. How the flying fudge did John Connor and Kate Brewster... How the hell did they know where to go to find this lair? They don't have a map.
They don't, Ellie,
but they were... They just run towards a lift and go, oh, well, I've set the detonator off now.
I know.
Not actually knowing where the lift's going.
Well, the thing with that is they...
The basement.
Really extensively, we discussed this, I think, about 5 or 10 episodes back when Kate's father, Colonel Brewster, told them that was a place they could actually go and hide out. As soon as he said what it was, the Terminator piped in with its 12 ascension over here with 3 degrees across the way, and that's where it's going to be, how to get there. You see? So that's where they were heading in that little plane when Arnold came and attack John and Kate.
I mean, Liz, is after the explosion, they then run out into this corridor where they could go anyway. They find a lift, and John just goes, "Oh yeah, it's down here. What I'll do is I'll set the detonator off right now."
The detonator. So very dangerous.
By the time we come back up, it should have gone, and we'll be safe, and we'll be fine. I just thought that was a bit presumptuous to think, "Oh, I know," or even, I don't know. I just think it's all very convenient. At no stage have I seen him with a map or anything. I know the Terminator knows what he's doing, but the Terminator isn't there anymore. He's kaput. Although he says that they'll meet again.
Well, we just have to assume that... nice try trying to save your question, by the way. But I think I'll help you out here. I guess John's been taught how to kind of map read. Kate knows how to fly a plane. So I can only assume because she's got knowledge of how to fly a plane, she will know all the things you would need to... by giving a grid reference on a map and being able to head towards it with the instrumentation within the plane. Not that I'm being an apologist for the movie, but I think that's probably the only thing.
I was going to say, whose side are you on?
I'm just looking forward to dragging your feet through Terminator Salvation for the next 3 months.
Oh, God! Is that how long the series takes?
No, it should take about 6 weeks, but obviously you're the co-host, so it takes 3 months.
Eking out the pleasure day by day. I'm sorry. That was a bit like, as if they'd know, as if you'd set off a detonate, why not detonate when you know exactly what the score is? I just thought that was massively presumptuous.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I couldn't
do
agree
you?
More. Do you?
Do you? And also, when they first come down into this fallout pad for VIPs, which is actually what John calls it.
Pips.
Do you not think that when they first go down to that room, made me think of two things. The first thing was it looked kind of like quite Nazi-ish, or maybe like the Illuminati kind of like hang out down there. It just had that kind of secret kind of circle kind of feel to it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It did. It massively made me think of kind of... Well, also a little bit, the Captain America, the second one. Again, it's all that kind of like hidden bases and, you know, maybe this is where Hitler was actually hanging out for all those years with the US military.
Yeah. Well, and, no, you know, Hitler went to Argentina, apparently.
With all the old computers. Although I thought those computers...
Oh, you're thinking of Captain America.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Okay. Yeah, well, that's a similar kind of place, I guess.
At least neither of us listen to what the other person says. If it was one-sided, it'd be unfair.
Sorry, I was reading a note. I was just going to say it took 6 months for the VFX pioneers to actually develop the method to simulate the sequence in which the TX's liquid exterior magnetized to the point of peeling off. That bit when she was kind of stuck on the Hadron Collider. And I'm obviously saying, I'm telling you the piece of trivia for a wrong clip. But... to show it revealing her endoskeleton, it took a year to research and develop that and completely animate the scene.
What a waste of a year.
Exactly. So it didn't look that good anyway. You know, when Arnie like shoves the, I guess, the detonator in the TX's mouth as well, various versions of lines were said. One of them being, "Eat me," that Arnold would have said. "Eat me."
That would have been better.
Would it?
Yeah.
Wouldn't you have said, "Eat this"?
So funny.
If she was just in a Hicks line from Aliens, "Eat this."
Eat me.
But the filmmakers finally settled basically on saying, him saying, "You're terminated," which also happens to echo Sarah Connor's final line. Final line from the it's
Terminator.
"You're terminated, fucker."
Fucker. Women, potty mouths.
Yeah.
Atrocious. I also like the fact that can we call this episode John's limp acting, because his limping in this particular scene is a great metaphor for the rest of his acting in the rest of this movie.
His acting of a limp is rubbish.
Both.
And it's limp acting.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's why I thought John's limp acting would be limp in capitals would be a really good title for this episode.
Ellie, it shall be done, just for you.
Yay! But I think he forgets every now and again that he's meant to be limping. So he kind of walks a bit normal, then puts on this really over-exaggerated, overacted limp again. Well, for fuck's sake, John.
You got to go now, John.
It is literally a fucking metaphor for his performance throughout this whole film. Now, what does John actually mean by this is a fallout pad for VIPs? So should the end of the world happen, this is where, like,
I think he assumed Samuel, he was gonna. I think he was gonna.
Samuel Jackson will hang out.
I think he assumed he was gonna run into like a giant room and just like blow the computer up or the control desk and would stop Skynet.
But then he seems like really affected and really upset and horrified. He's like, "Oh my god, they didn't even know. Oh my god, they didn't have a chance. Like, what the fuck is he talking about?"
I can't remember now, and I should know this because we're talking about it. But I think this is a misdirect on behalf of the Terminator. I think the Terminator actually sends them to safety. If they'd gone to the other base, I think that would have been blown up by one of Skynet's kind of like enemies in the Counter-Strike.
I get that, but one of the things that John actually says is when he's freaking out, he said they never got the warning. What the fuck is he talking about?
I don't know, and if we paid more attention to our own show, I think we'd both know. Sorry, everyone.
Well, this was always,
I think, if I remember correctly, it's a misdirect, isn't it? I think he sends them to safety to guarantee John's life, basically. Now, I'm not sure if that's actually helpful or a hindrance. I think he just wants to complete his mission, so it's just Terminator ego.
Whoa! There's a whole new concept I hadn't thought of. Do the Terminators have egos?
Well, once again, we come back to the Ghost in the Machine conversation of, like, you know, love, ego.
Oh, the music was perfect.
What for?
We said love, and there was this beautiful string quartet. Love.
This is what my love sounds like.
More like Tubbs. What is love?
What is love? Baby, don't hurt me.
We were going to go to Plymouth.
Yeah, I think John's been sent here just to guarantee his safety by the Terminator. But yeah. The thing is, when they come, how do they leave this base now?
How do they?
I imagine there's no other way out. I mean, the explosion on the actual under the door, the still open door of the base, which would have sent a nuclear fire through every level, corridor, down into the ground, however deep this base goes, and up into the mountain. So much so, the outside of the mountain cracks and like crumbles off. Hundreds of feet above the actual door, and they do like the outside shot, that digital mat.
Yeah, but neither of them seem to show any damage when they're attacked by the fucking TX, so as if a small little explosion like that would actually do anything.
I just find it hilarious that, like,
it's like seeing Kate now, she's literally got the smallest little scratch on her forehead when she was thrown into that helicopter by a fucking Terminator.
Well, not just the helicopter, she was thrown into the that kind of like snap-on tools trolley.
Maybe she's a Terminator.
Maybe she is.
Can you imagine that? If at the end of this, Brewster had actually been a Terminator all along. Fucking lying bitch.
Well, they kind of ran out of ideas because that's what they kind of did with Genesis. It was like, who do we make the Terminator in a twist? And we go, we'll make John Connor the Terminator.
Oh, we'll make it John Connor.
But then we'll put it in like the first trailer, therefore ruining the surprise. Which Alan Taylor, the director of Terminator Genesis, was really pissed off about that, apparently.
I'm not surprised. Everyone knew the story. I
always assumed, like, the director would also would at least cut the trailer or oversee the trailer being cut.
Yeah, I would have assumed that would have been the person to have done it anyway.
You just finish your movie and then you hand it over to the movie studio and they go, right, we're going to market this. Oh, that's good. Look, John Connor's a Terminator. It was just very strange.
Hoo-ah!
Hoo-ah!
How come you haven't done a podcast yet with Beryl?
Because I was working the entire weekend on the Scientology documentary.
Oh, of course you were. Have you discussed this, by the way?
I mentioned it in the last episode, but if you haven't listened to the last episode, you're just joining us. I did an episode called Scientology Exposed with Tony Ortega, and Tony Ortega is one of the main kind of like anti-Scientology journalists out there. He runs a blog called The Underground Bunker. He did a book called The Unbreakable Miss Lovely, which I mispronounced in the opening of the show, which was great.
I did notice that. I was like, oh.
Do you know why? I thought.
And then you go, I'm sorry, I'm just so nervous. And I was like, nicely recovered. It's not actually that you're a dyslexic fuck and you can't read.
Well, it's because the unbearable lightness of being went across my mind, which is a famous book and movie, and it just came out like that. But I was genuinely nervous from the fact I'm really worried about talking about Scientology.
I know, and you should be.
The amount of flack he's had, I was expecting, like, it still could happen, like weird noises on my telephone and like black vans outside the house with people harassing me. I think they've changed their policy on that now, where they kind of harass people because they've already got such a bad name. It's a scary subject to talk about.
It is. I just love the fact that you and that David Wells guy actually found one of their kind of, like, what would that even be? Like a meet out, like a meeting place, or like somewhere where they have lectures or something.
Yeah.
You stumbled across some house and they came out and there was like a car with black.
No, that was a Scientology British base, basically in East Sussex in East Grinstead, I think.
Yeah, dude, that sounded fun. That sounded like such fun.
And we drove into that, turned around, kind of on their forecourt. And loads of people just came out and surrounded the car and were asking questions. Then we kind of got out of there. Then we got followed by a car, we think. It was a...
proper spy business, man.
Yeah, it was very, very strange. Scary.
Are you scared?
Excited, scared.
Did a little bit of wee come out?
Yeah.
Yeah. Did that happen when you first watched this film?
Yes. Battle Beyond the Stars. Actually, if anyone's not seen it, Battle Beyond the Stars is actually pretty good.
What is it?
It's made by Roger Corman. It was one of kind of like the Roger Corman studios who actually James Cameron worked for. James Cameron was a matte artist for Roger Corman. Roger Corman made Pit and the Pendulum. He did loads of he did a Little Shop of Horrors, the 60s version with Jack Nicholson. He's like a B-movie film director, basically. He'd do things on the cheap. When Star Wars came out, they made Battle Beyond the Stars in 1980, which was a rip-off of Star Wars. It's got George Peppard in it, Robert Vaughn, Sylvia Crystal. It's really good.
Sounds it.
But the thing that makes it even a better film than it actually is the score by James Horner. And I think this was one of his first major scores. I mean, from this, he did Wrath of Khan, Star Trek III, The Search for Spock. So, he was kind of an out-of-the-box musical genius.
Nice. Yeah, no, James Horner's a favourite, but he's fucking dead, man.
He is.
What did he actually die of?
Crashed his plane.
Oh, my God.
I don't know if he had a heart attack or lost control of the plane or something mechanically went wrong with it, but yeah.
I crashed my plane. What more do you have to say about the 2 minutes, Ethan?
I've kind of said all what I need to say, basically. We've covered
a lot
of things.
Were there no cock-ups?
No.
The fuck, man?
It's because it's wrapping up, basically. I mean, after this, we're going to see the nuclear bombs fall, and then that's kind of the end of the movie.
Oh, yeah, what happens to Ethan Zanis after he's douched too much?
We should...
evacuates brown.
I guess in a couple
liquids.
Of episodes, we're going to do... let's actually see what we've got left. I think because we're in the home stretch, we seem to run out of energy.
No,
we've actually
got
9 more episodes to go.
Really?
Yeah, now I imagine...
Some of that's going to be credits, though.
I think 5 of those are actually going to be credits, so we might just do like a super-duper 40-minute or hour-long episode covering all like 10 minutes of the credits. Because
who doesn't want to talk about credits?
Exactly. And then hopefully...
to Genesis.
Hopefully, even though we're getting a sense from Ellie of not wanting to do this anymore, we are very near the end, Ellie. And I think with hard work... we can wrap this up in like 3.5-4 months.
Awesome. It's only because it's Salvation, man. I fucking hate that film. It's so bad.
Well, I've got lots and lots of notes on that, even actually more so now than I've actually gathered initially for the first time round. So it should be better. And the very fact... I don't know. Watching it again, I'm still torn about Salvation. I'm not sure if it's actually better than Terminator 3.
What?
They're both terrible. But at least...
So have you watched that in recent times then, Salvation?
Yeah, I've had to watch it again, haven't I? But I think the main reason is, I think at least they tried to do something different. Because obviously 3 is kind of a retread of that. The same way, I guess, 4 is the same as that. A Terminator comes, it chases people. At least they tried to kind of like... bring it to an interesting angle. Marcus Wright is a Terminator. Sorry, spoilers if you haven't seen it. They just tried, they came at the story from a different angle. I mean, the only thing, it doesn't look like a Terminator film, and it's all shot in the day for the most part, so, which isn't very Terminator.
No.
I think perhaps if it like kept some of those elements and kept it, you know, at night and not put so much of their own stink on it and kept some Terminator elements.
Yeah.
Well, that's what filmmakers do, don't they? They like, when, let's say Marco, who did Arthur and Merlin, wrote a script and was all set to go on it, and they accepted his script, and then for whatever reason, the studio decides he's not experienced enough to make this movie. They'll hand it over to someone else. That director then will go, well, I'm going to rewrite the script the way I want and just write his own script, which is what happens with a lot of... in fact, it happened with Tim Burton and Superman, the Death of Superman.
Oh, really?
Kevin Smith wrote the script for that. It was all set to go. Tim Burton came on board, and then all of a sudden, his script was scrapped, and Tim Burton wrote his own script. The film obviously didn't pan out in the end anyway for a million Hollywood reasons.
So Kevin Smith was going to do it?
Kevin Smith wrote the script.
Fucking hell.
Because he mentions in Morrats that like the superhero sex he writes about, and would Lois be able to have Superman's baby, or would he shoot a load out of a back like a shotgun?
Based
purely on that, he got to do the spec script for The Death of Superman. Or Superman Lives, rather. Superman Lives. But then it didn't pan out. But like the process of that happening, Tim Burton came aboard as a director and then like sacked off Kevin Smith's script.
Shit, son. Get Kevin Smith back. Yeah, no, I reckon he probably would have done it. But then again, I haven't seen the film. But you are a film buff, and everyone else I know that's seen it said it was shit. Oh dear.
Everyone else has seen what?
Batman versus Superman.
Yeah, it is. It's it doesn't work. I mean, I'm sure people are going to write and go, "You're wrong," because loads of people on the line are going, "It's the best film ever." It's actually not. They've tried to.
They think about Star Wars, so.
They've crammed in Doomsday, The Death of Superman, and The Dark Knight Returns, the Frank Miller comic. They've put three comics into one film. It's nearly 3 hours long. And it's just a mess. It's edited really confusingly. It's murky. It's dreary looking. It's always raining. It's night. Lex Luthor, even though they try to do something different with him, he goes completely batshit crazy in the film and gets put in prison. Therefore, you've lost Lex Luthor out of your franchise, because where'd you go after that? When Lex Luthor is meant to be this like charming, intelligent businessman like the president.
Yeah.
That, a bit like Sophie, like says whatever she wants and gets away with it, and no one listens to me. That's what Lex Luthor is. He's beyond reproach. That's why Superman can't kill him or get him, and Batman can't get him either. Like he just kind of outsmarts him because he's like super intelligent and this respected businessman and like prince of the city, if you will.
Yeah.
In this, he's this kind of like Facebook Mark Zuckerberg character with all these crazy tics and things. And it's strange. It doesn't really work. And Superman, of course, kills people willy-nilly, which Superman shouldn't ever do, because the whole point of Superman, he's better than us.
Hmm.
He's like this bright, shining symbol of hope. Even though they mentioned that in the first film, he's anything but hope. He trashes the city at the end of Man of Steel, as we all know.
Yeah.
And then he just trashes more city in this. Batman uses a gun, which Batman never does.
Whoa! For real?
Not to shoot harpoons, an actual gun.
Oh my God.
Therefore, weakening the character of Batman, because the whole point is...
Batman gone mad.
Batman is meant to be this non-lethal weapon-using ninja, and by showing that, you actually show he's not, and he just needs a gun, which Batman doesn't do. He kills people, which Batman doesn't do. Batman's main role in all of the comic books, for the most part, I know they deviate here and there, is Batman never kills, because a gun killed his parents.
Especially, and also with the gun, that's the reason why he doesn't use it, because his parents were shot, right?
Exactly. And also, it's like a Jedi Knight would never use a gun, even though, yes, Hugh McGregor uses a gun in Revenge of the Sith, but then he gets so uncivilized. None of the characters act that way. And I think you can change and alter aspects of a character, but I think in a film, you can't really mess with the classic tenets of the character the same way if you had Romeo and Juliet, but they never meet and never fall in love. You can't, yeah. you have a Robin Hood film, he doesn't rob from anyone. They're a classic, it's like having Robinson Crusoe, but he never gets stuck on an island. It takes away the main elements that make that character the character. And if you're going to do that, yeah. you may as well just do a different character.
And also, like you said, with the Marvel films, they've built it up over like 6 or 7 movies. Yeah. And then
Captain America. Captain America, I guess Shazam is the closest thing. I know he's DC, isn't he? Captain Marvel, maybe, but I think one of the closest things in character to Superman that Marvel has is Captain America, because he's from a different time, a different place. He's got a different set of values, and he's like morally, I guess, better than anyone else.
Yeah, but I think a lot of it is actually he's quite innocent.
Exactly, and he's thrust into this kind of like cynical world, which is what Superman is. You can have that with Superman. This Superman just moans, complains all the time. He's moody, and he kills people left, right, and center. And I'm sorry, Superman just doesn't do that. If you want a superhero to do that, pick a different superhero, because there's lots of them that are dark and kill and do all those things. And the film doesn't have any kind of levity or kind of that action-adventure feel that you used to get from a film, I think, which is what the Marvel films have retained. You can't obviously do that for every film. I know DC is obviously like a darker kind of thing, but there's no sense of adventure or fun with it. It's just a really not a good film. And even on a filmmaking basis, it's very boring and nothing happens, but it does. It's really messy. You can't follow the story threads. It's all over the place. They've tried to put 7 films worth of action adventure into one film and just fucked it up completely.
Wow. I do kind of really want to see it now, though.
Weirdly, the big action sequence, all the stuff you see in the film that are good, are all the bits in the trailer. There's no surprises apart from.
I'll be honest with you, I haven't even seen the trailer.
And the only good thing in it really is, even though he uses a gun, but the bits where Batman is kind of being Batman, they're the best bits. Now, that's because the film is very Batman centric, and they kind of sideline Superman again, which is silly. Because it should be like an equal footing. The reason they're put up to fight by Lex saying to Superman, I've kidnapped your mother, I'm going to kill her unless you pick a fight with Batman, is a silly, dramatic reason to fight Batman. Batman not liking Superman is explored initially, saying he's a dangerous alien, anything could happen, I need to take him out. But then that's not the reason he fights Superman, so they kind of lose that story thread. There's no real reason or anything behind the story for it to kind of be that way. It's very, I don't know.
I wonder what our listeners think. I wonder if Spalding's seen it.
I think lots of people like it because they go, oh, it's a new Batman Superman film, and they don't actually think about this character or the story. You, like, if you were going to have a superhero that kills everyone left, right, and centre.
Who's the casting director?
It's not that. It's the filmmakers that choose things. The person that wrote
the
script.
No, but I want to know who fucking ever chose Ben Affleck to be Batman.
But despite all that, he's actually the best Batman and Bruce Wayne, I think.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my god.
The way he fights and stuff, the big scene that everyone's seen in the trailers, which is that kind of like when he takes out a bunch of like guys in this warehouse, but they've kind of ripped that directly off the Batman Arkham games.
They are amazing.
Yeah, so all the fights that Batman, well, the only fight, sorry, that Batman has, he's kind of done in that style where he's just kind of like running through and beating like 7 guys up at the same time, punching them through walls and stuff. He looks really cool. But then all the other times, he's just killing people. There's a chase with the Batmobile, and he just runs all the cars off the road, killing everyone in the cars. He then blows up more cars with people in them, whereas the true Batman would do that in a much more clever and non-lethal way. And this Batman doesn't do that, and it's very strange. I don't know, it's just you don't need that. And also, if it's still ultimately...
Maybe they just wanted to capture the darker side of it, I don't know.
But in every Batman film, they've kind of done that. And you can do Batman dark without killing people. You really can. It's a testament then to his character that he's such a badass that he can take anyone out without firing a weapon. That's not to say you won't break your arm or your leg or your neck where he sends you to Arkham Asylum or prison, Blackgate Prison. But yeah, it's just weird seeing Batman shooting people and blowing things up willy-nilly. I think they did that in the Michael Keaton film. And everyone kind of universally agreed that's not kind of what Batman does. Tim Burton clearly hadn't picked up a comic book, and I think it's quite evident that Zack Snyder.
Yeah, because Tim Burton's way more kind of like chiaroscuro, isn't he? More kind of macabre. He's definitely into the more.
But
dark,
again, you could have that without him shooting people. I think at the end of the day, ultimately, if you do like a spin-off, an experimental filmmaker's doing a Batman film, fine. But if you're in a mainstream Batman film, that should really, even though it's dark or an action adventure, should be a family film ultimately.
Mm. Yeah, no, I do agree.
It's just dark and dreary, and Superman, I'm sorry. You need to make him in that classic. If it's for a, obviously they've done Red Sun and things with Mark DC, and there's different like versions of Superman. One where he kind of like the baby lands in Russia, and he becomes like the Russian version of Superman called the Red Sun. It's just weird. Like even Superman's kind of adoptive parents are like, oh, don't bother saving anyone, Clark. And it's like the whole point of Superman is he has all those values because his spaceship crashed by that farmhouse with those like morally upstanding good people. They're the reason Superman is who he is, and that's the reason he's better than everyone else, not just physically but also morally, and all that's thrown out the window. It's just a really weird way of approaching Superman, because he's exactly like Batman at that point. So yeah. What's the point of
Batman?
Yeah, you're having two characters go up against each other, which are doing the same things and are essentially the same character, bar wearing a cowl. But
what,
hey,
what do the listeners think?
I personally, if you've not seen it yet, listeners, wait for it for Netflix DVD, or if you're really naughty, find it somewhere on the internet. But it's not good. I wasn't happy spending.
In other
like,
words, don't spend like £30 seeing it at the cinema.
Yeah, if you're in London, fool, forget about it.
Is it that much cheaper in Birmingham to go to the cinema?
Well, it's like between,
I know it's up north. So
it's between £7 and £9 here.
Oh my god! Then again, Dorking, even though Dorking isn't massive, it's a decent cinema, and it's only like £9 there, I think.
Yeah, but if you go to London, it'll be like 17.
Oh yeah, I know. But that's a London thing, isn't it? Is there anything else you wanted to add to this particular?
No, I
show?
Think we encapsulated my passionate diatribe about Batman v Superman.
Superman.
Sorry, I had some trapped wind then. I was like,
thank you so much for tuning in and listening. We appreciate it.
Thank you all, everyone. Hopefully we'll be back tomorrow with an enthusiastic Ellie with who's going to study the clips and take copious notes. We're going to come out with two like amazing shows. Forgive the two damp
squibs. I've taken notes on all of them.
Well, this was great near the end. You know what it is? I think this film, it's kind of because it's winding down, nothing much is happening, and there's a lot of reasonless stuff in it, and there's no drive to kind of like make you go, oh, I'm into this. There's a few like moments we've discussed and things, but I think on the whole, it's a bit flat, this movie, isn't it?
Massively.
And on that bombshell,
Bailey J's chebs.
But very much like the last few episodes of this show, except for the last 10 minutes of this one. Thank you all for listening, everyone. We shall return.
Hasta la vista.
Oh, hasta la vista.
Machines. I'll be back.